Go. Welcome back to Video Hits. These boys had a massive success with their last album and they're back with another one now. We're here in their rehearsal studio, hopefully not to annoy them. They are The Script. Hello, The Script.
Hello.
How are you guys? How are you?
Very well. Are we annoying you?
Yes.
Not yet. No, it's a much needed break. We've been killing each other all day over how things sound, how they don't sound. So it's great to just kind of get out and do something different.
Just keep us here as long as you can.
Because we've pulled you out of your rehearsal space.
Yeah, without alcohol, I will add, so.
Where's the no bar here? Or a swimming pool? Nothing.
No, there's nothing.
No swimming pool.
No liquids.
So, this is your rehearsal studio. It's called John Henry's. Is it famous?
Very famous, yes.
Extremely.
It's not actually ours. It's owned by Mr. Henry himself.
Sure,
and of course, there's lots of big bands come through here all the time. So pretty much every band in town.
Oasis, Robbie Williams.
Yeah, there's
name them.
As you walk around,
you see them on the walls.
Yeah. Are they all the people that have been here?
Yeah. They've all signed.
Bob Marley, Jimi Hendrix, the Beatles, the Rolling Stones,
the Police,
George Michael,
UB40.
Eric Clapton. They're all on the wall. There's pictures of them as you go down the stairs. So if you get your camera and have a little look later, you'll be able to get it all. It's pretty cool.
Nicely. You're amongst excellent company. Does that enter your feelings and when you're jamming?
No pressure. As you're just standing there looking at like Coldplay sign thing on the wall or a YouTube. You can only fall short, can't you?
It helps to know they've been here and that we're here. So it's a nice
exactly.
Nice thing.
There you go. Now, last time you were in Australia, massive stir. Everyone loved it.
Right.
Yes.
Nice.
Great.
You must have felt that love, correct?
Yeah, absolutely. Our tour was mental over there and they made us feel really at home, I have to say. Australia's like it's just another Europe really in a lot of ways. There's so many people from Ireland and England there that they come out of the woodwork when we're over there. It was
big
brilliant.
And I think just like Irish people, they just get behind a band they like, and if they really like a song, they'll sing it louder than us. They put more passion into the singing of it at a live show than we do. And you know, being Irish, being passionate people, we can't help but just reciprocate that energy. It's great. Love the Australians.
It makes your job easy, Danny.
Yeah, it's just kind of going back to the court.
Yeah.
Job done. Thank you. Good night.
I'm having a tea while everyone else sings. Well, you came armed with some killer tracks with their last tour.
Thank you. We Cry,
Before the Worst, The Man Who Can't Be Moved, Break Even, amongst a whole lot of others, all off your first and self-titled album. We're going to play We Cry in just a moment. I need to ask this stupid question that I've always believed that Before the Worst is about German sausage. Is that true?
Before the curry verse.
Before the verse?
Before the verse.
The curry verse.
The curry verse.
Very good observation.
Yeah, we were in Berlin and a German sausage annoyed the crap out of us, and we figured if we go back before the verse, it would be
if we could go back before that sausage ever entered our lives, it would all be different.
It's terrible heartburn off that.
What beautiful topics you boys write about. Can we get into We Cry then?
Yes.
Are we ready?
Yes, let's do it.
Let's do it. Video Hits.
Welcome back to Video Hits. We are coming to you from London town this morning, hanging with The Script. Science and faith. Science and faith.
Yeah.
Science
the
and faith.
New album, I know, yeah. We just got out of the studio, fresh out of the studio. And we, it took maybe about 4 months.
4 months in total.
4 months in total. As soon as we opened the floodgates of writing, all these songs just seemed to pour out of us, on the first album. And Science and Faith just seemed to be a title that was provocative, but I think anybody who knows The Script knows that we're not trying to be political or religious or anything by that. It's just, talking about our own lives and trying to inject a little bit of the universe in there. I think we touched on some great subjects in there, which there is a title track called Science and Faith in there, which deals with, I guess it was an argument or a conversation.
I think it was an argument. between myself and my wife, actually. Yeah, on national television, here we go, I'm going to tell everybody, this is going to go down well. No, it's basically, I suppose we write about our lives and all those things that go on with guys in their mid-20s, and this album is very much a reflection of all that stuff that's been going on for us, and I wouldn't like to say we bettered the last album, I just think this is a big continuation for us, you know.
What was the argument?
I'm trying to avoid the argument.
Yeah, he's
He repeats it now, she'll hear it.
She'll hear it, and then I'm...
Only if she watches it on YouTube, though.
I know, she's seen you jumping into a swimming pool.
Okay.
There's a high possibility.
Yeah, she
you remember the whole swimming pool, isn't it?
Yes. Like, why don't you jump into the swimming pool? This is the swimming pool right now. You want me to jump in, and I don't want to.
It's actually quite a good bit of footage. I do an Irish jig. I actually curse, we're all cursing in it, and you fuzzy right into the pool.
Yeah,
it was good.
I've been well behaved today.
We're not going to get an Irish juice.
Yeah. Maybe later in the credits are rolling.
He's the jig person in the band.
Really?
Yeah.
Do you do some river dancing as well?
I do some late at night and drink a lot, so I do the liver dance.
Yeah, we do it with part
liver
of the
dance. Liver dance. That's not a river dance. It's different.
No, but it's different. It's the drunk version. It's the liver dance.
Yeah. I can't wait to see this.
We're on tour. We're on tour with it as well.
Clearly not from London. Clearly from Ireland, but being in London here. What other Irish pastimes do you get up to? What's that Irish sport?
Hurling.
Yes, hurling.
Gaelic.
Hurling. Yeah.
Hurling.
It's not like when you get too drunk, you puke.
No.
You're hurling.
See how far you can puke. You know.
Now we've got two national sports. One is Gaelic football, which is it's like football, but you can actually use your hands. Mm. It's a lot easier. It's like you know, 24 goalkeepers out there.
It's a round ball, isn't it?
Yeah, it's a round ball. Yeah. It's kind of like Aussie rules.
Very like Aussie rules.
Just less fighting.
The Australian rules footballers go over.
They play every year.
That's right, actually. Yeah.
Every year they
That's
play. Right.
There's always a bust up. There's no more of those games anymore because the last time it was so rough. They were just killing each other. I mean, really, before it even started. I'm not joking.
They're physical.
Oh, yeah.
Those Irish.
Yeah. Those Aussies.
And curling is that the thing where they
it's
use
hurling.
The hurling?
Curling.
Curling is a different thing. It's when you curl your hair.
You don't do that.
No, of course.
It's all natural.
Hurling is actually used with a stick. It's short on one end and it's quite long on the other end, and it's a flat as opposed to a baseball bat, but this is flat and it's got something kind of like a palm on the end, and you use a ball called a schlitter.
Yeah.
And a schlitter is actually it's really the hardest of baseball, and you hit it, but it's
I'm trying to imagine if I didn't know this sport what that picture
is. Yeah. I know, yeah, it's kind of like there's a hand at the end of a
thing called
it's like a baseball bat, but it's flat.
You know, the ball's called Slytherin, like in Harry Potter.
Yeah,
it's a snake.
Should be a royalty there for the Irish people.
Oh my god.
The schlitter and the hurdle.
We need to talk about your first single from the record, mm-hmm. For the First Time. It has a fascinating and beautiful story behind it about going home to Ireland.
We had been on tour for 2 years straight, and you know, a band has their whole life to write the first record, and you like 4 months to write your second, you know.
Yeah.
And we'd been coming off tour with all that kind of energy from, you know, dying to get into the studio and write a new album. And we got back to Dublin and wanted to, I suppose, share all the success we have had with the script, because, you know, only 2 years previous we were in the welfare line in Dublin, you know, hoping something like this would happen to us. Mm. And I suppose we went back hoping to share that with the same friends who had told us to get a real job, you know. We were hit with a very stark reality, which was, you know, friends of ours were going through a really hard time because of the recession had hit Ireland. The song is not necessarily a recession song. It's more about two of our friends that are going through the recession and dealing with having no job and having no money, and finally meeting after 20 years being together, actually feeling like not having those things, you feel like you're finally meeting for the first time, if you know what I mean. And that's
what the song is.
Absolutely.
Yeah. They say, well, like, you know, staying in is the new going out. You know, when you don't have money, you tend to connect to the things that are important, your friends, your family. You realise, God, we haven't done this in ages. Just whatever, get out, you know, whatever, Twister or an LT bottle of wine and just have fun in your own home. And we just thought that, you know what, it's a great message for people to realise that although times are hard, there's a beautiful upside. You may have nothing, but in losing everything, you realise that you're finding each other. You know, and we just felt compelled to write about this. Like, I guess as the script always does, it's just to find what's the most emotional thing you can kind of imagine at that time and then try and pen it. You know, and that was it. You know, I think everybody, we thought we were writing about our own, like, as in We Cry as well, we thought we were writing about our own circumstances. But you realise everybody's going through the same, even more so nowadays, you know.
Twister.
Yeah, Twister, I know, yeah.
You know, that's what I want to do.
See, there's always an upside. There's always, but there's always
Twister at the end of the day.
Which one? It wasn't darts or cards.
Mister.
So, big tour ahead.
Yeah.
Where are you hitting up?
We're only doing a short one in Australia this time. We're out there on the 5th of October and the 6th of October. 5th is Melbourne, 6th is Sydney, I believe, is that right?
That's correct.
Only two cities,
but
bigger venues.
Yeah,
so all the people that we used to have to spread out and do 20 small clubs can all come to one size, a decent sized place, and come in and see us.
Everyone from Adelaide and
Perth. Oh, I've got lots of family in Melbourne.
Have you?
Yeah, my brother's in Melbourne. His two children are there as well.
Yeah, right. What's their address?
They live in, I don't know, 13 St Kilda. I don't know.
St Kilda, okay. Yeah. We're that close.
Yeah.
We're checking them down.
Here's his phone number right here.
Cool. Where else are you going?
We actually start off in Ireland, then the album launches in Ireland, then we move through England. We've got a big tour here as well. And that takes us through Japan, Australia, and then we hit America. Kind of end up there. and then come back here.
You hear yourself says, like, yeah, we're going to Japan, and we're going
to It's like a holiday, you know, what? Except we get to go and play music and hopefully have people scream at us and not throw stuff, so it's really good.
The Americans love you.
We've been doing well over there. Break even, just like in Australia, it kind of repeated that story in America. We weren't even there. We went back and realised that the place had just gone nuts for that one song, and we had to re-release Man Who Can't Be Moved and things like that in order to, we've just captured the American attention, so we thought we'd go back with that. So our massive tour over there, it's all sold out, and it's a little bit crazy for us to go to any country where your tour is sold out, you know. It's nuts.
World domination.
Yes, we'll see what happens.
Scriptination.
Sure. Would you like to make a request?
We can't think of one, I don't think. I think this is the deer in the headlights moment for the
script. I'd love a Big Mac, large fries, Diet Coke.
You know what?
I'm here. Sorry,
were you going to say temper trap?
Yeah,
there you go. I like temper trap.
Actually, great. Because they're from your side of the world, aren't they?
Okay.
We met them too. Nice guys.
They're very, very nice guys. We met them backstage at the
Meteor Awards.
And the guys are brilliant. We got the album and we haven't stopped listening to it since.
Very nice. Yeah, a particular track?
This one in particular grabbed my attention. I loved it because it was like almost U2 meets Fine Young Cannibals meets, you know.
Fine Young Cannibals.
Yeah, do you remember them?
Yeah.
Surprise me, crazy.
And I can't save her. The same sort of thing going on.
My wife thought I looked a bit like that guy, and then she married me.
Yep.
She must have really liked him.
Thank you so much for letting us into your
Thank
world
you.
And your rehearsal
space.
Thank you
for stepping into
our
world.
Very much.
Did we annoy you?
Absolutely.
Not yet.
Yeah, still got time.
You worked with that kind of, that, out of tune a little bit.
I wasn't out of tune.
It freaked me out a little bit. Hang on, was it? It was,
No, I was annoying. The script on Video Hits. For the first time, brand new clip.
Yep.
Tell us about it, go.
We decided to try something a little bit different with this one. We made basically a 6-minute movie, which represents the song. So basically, this is going to be online for people to view as an actual movie with dialogue and actors and all this sort of stuff. And what we've done then is we've gone into a studio. We've never done something like this before, and we shot the band kind of very, very intimate in our performance. And that's also going to be an independent thing. So then we're going to put both of them together. And what you're about to see will be the finished version of both of those two together, where the music video is us obviously singing the song in a studio, but there's actually, we've shot a 6-minute movie that we're going to edit all together. So this is what you're going to watch. I hope you like it.
Cool.
Nicely. The script.
How you doing? We got a script and we're coming to a town near you on tour. We got a very, very special guest, Michael Painter. And we are also starting off in Melbourne on the 5th of October. Mm-hmm. So please come down. We're starting off in the Palace. It's going to be absolutely amazing. And then we go to...
On the 6th, we go to Sydney. I can't quite figure out where it is
right
now.
Big Top Luna Park.
Go online. Is it
Big Top Luna Park?
Big Top Luna Park. See that?
He's all rehearsed.
We're both about Jake together.
Yeah.
Why drag me into your jig? I ain't
jig. No, I'm not saying you. I'm saying me and Fuzzy.
Oh, you can jig away.
That's what I'm saying.
Fuzzy with jig.
Yeah.
I'll jig away.
Jigger.
Time to get jiggy,
yo. Time to get jiggy with it.
Get jiggy.
Yeah.
I like it.
Yeah. Let's go.
We're getting jiggy. Come on. Gorgeous. There you go. Getting jiggy with it.
That's my field!
I can't believe you can actually play it!
Yeah!
Oh my lord.
Where'd you get that?
Ireland.
That's brilliant.
That's when you play there with
somebody. I know he's really good.